Bringing people and communities together on seclosounds.org.
Hi, I'm Terry Sullivan, and thanks for tuning in to today's Sticks Radio Show here on Seclo Sounds. My guest today is Gordy Marshall. For many years, he's been the drummer with the Moody Blues. He's currently on a super band called Reflections. They're playing locally. We'll be talking about that much later. In fact, after this record, this is from the Moody Blues, and this is the fabulous Go Now.
We've already said...
Today on the show, my guest is Gordy Marshall. He's part of the Reflections in Concert Tour. How are you doing, Gordy?
I'm very well, thank you, Terry. Nice to talk to you.
And you. And we'll talk about your career to start off with. I mean, you're with four other world-class musicians, singers and songwriters on this tour, but we'll talk about yourself first. I mean, you moved to London at a very, reasonably young age, didn't you?
Yeah, well, 22 is young, I suppose. Actually, at my age, anything lower than 30 is young, but I was 22 when I moved to London, and with my very good friend Peter Howarth, who is now the lead singer of the Hollies.
He was on the show.
And the Reflections that you talk about. He mentioned, actually, Peter and I, Peter was our first singer, but he's not, because of diary conflicts and a few other technical details, unfortunately, he was really gutted that he couldn't continue with us. But we now have Mick Wilson, the lead singer of 10cc, singing with us, so we are rather more than delighted.
Yeah, I know. We're going to be playing some, you sent me some sort of rough tracks that you've recorded with Mick.
Yeah. Mick, yeah.
That we'll play during the show, which are quite mind-blowing. There's a Cliffe song, there's a 10cc song, and then there's the famous Nights in White Satin. So we'll be playing them during the show. So when you came to London with Peter...
Peter and I moved... Well, basically, we both lived in Blackpool at the time. We were sort of gigging in the local clubs and pubs of Blackpool, and we came to London to seek our fame and fortune, which didn't happen for a number of years. Peter was the first one to get a proper break when he got the gig with Cliffe Richard, and I worked with Cliffe since then, actually. But we played together in a band. We were signed to a record label, we had a deal, we had a band called Sahara, but nothing really happened with that, and then we sort of went off on our separate ways doing session work. Although we remained the best of mates, he now lives in North London and I live in South London. As you probably realise, that you may as well be a different country. So, in fact, he was round here this morning. He popped in for a coffee this morning, so I saw him this morning. I was down here, and it took me a good 10 years, actually, before I became fully established. And I got the gig with the Moody Blues in 1991. So I moved down here in 82. So it took me 9 years.
Yeah. What were you doing up in Blackpool? Were you gigging up there before you came to
Yes, I did. Well, I did the North Shore Working Men's Club for one. No, I don't think it's there anymore. I also played at the ABC Theatre, and I did pantomimes and summer seasons and nightclubs and anything that... weddings, bar mitzvahs, anything that was going, basically.
But they paid the bills, basically, then.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
I was still living with my mum, actually, until about age 20. She was keeping me. Then I moved to London and did it on my own.
Mm. So you say you worked with Cliffe Richard.
Yeah.
I mean, that must have been a great gig. Cliffe is an icon, an idol. Whether you like him or loathe him, he's been around for what, since the middle 50s?
Yes, he has. The gig with Cliffe. I only did a few of them. The first one I did was the Diamond Awards in Belgium. And it was the first proper big concert I've ever done in the stadium, you know. And it was just simply fantastic. You say like him all over him. Of course, we love him because he's a national treasure. And regardless, and when I hear people say dispassionate things about him or say derogatory things about him, rather, it does make me cringe a bit because he's such a great singer. He's never really put a foot wrong in doing anything. He's not one of those bad boy guys. Probably that's one of the things that goes against him. If he'd have been a bit more rock and roll, maybe the media would have loved him a bit more. I don't know. But Mick Wilson, our lead singer, worked with him for 2 years. Huw Davies, our guitarist in the band, in the Reflections band, has also played for him, and I've played for him. So we include a number of Cliffe's hits in our Reflections set because they're just such great songs.
I mean, he's written some because I think you're probably right. He's the squeaky clean image some people don't like. It's a bit like Daniel O'Donnell. I think people are always trying to look for the skeleton in the closet.
Yeah, exactly.
And I don't get that. I mean, I must admit, I don't ever do that sort of thing. I'm not that interested.
No. I think, actually, if we were to be really honest, we do get it because there's nothing we like better than a little bit of salacious news from somebody or other. And that's what the people... That's what the media like, of course, in order to sell papers. But that's not we're not in that. You and I are not in that business, Terry.
I don't find that.
No, we're not.
You know, all right. It's perhaps great if he's a politician falls on his sword or whatever. But you know, I don't really get it. But so then you with the Moody Blues. I mean, they were already a very established band when you joined them.
They were in 1991, of course. I mean, their first hit was in 1968. Tuesday Afternoon was their first hit. Of course, it wasn't. Go Now was their first number one. That was when Denny Lane was singing with them. And, of course, he famously went off with Paul McCartney to start Wings. And then Justin Hayward joined along with John Lodge, and that's when they recorded Days of Future Past, which, of course, was the album that Decca produced in order to demonstrate their newfangled technology called stereo. And obviously Nights in White Satin and Tuesday Afternoon came off that album, and the rest is sort of history. 75 million albums later, the rest is history. So when I joined them in 91, they were truly well established, and I joined right at the top, which was fantastic.
Because you met a keyboard player called Paul Bliss.
I did. Paul joined on the very same day that I joined the Moody Blues in 1991. But he worked on the album in the studio with them. They created an album called Keys of the Kingdom in 91, a great album. Paul had worked in the studio playing keyboards and doing some programming, because Paul's an amazing producer and writer and programmer, as well as being a great keyboard player. And so when I turned up for the first rehearsals at Bray Studios, Paul was there with his keyboards, and that's when we sort of first met each other.
Mm. And you worked together for, what, 20 years?
Yeah, we worked. Well, Paul stopped playing with the band about 4 or 5 years ago now. So about 17 or 18 years, he and I were touring buddies all over the world with the Moodies. It was simply fantastic.
I bet there's some great stories of the times you toured with the
Moodies. Oh, my God, yes. I've written a book called Postcards from a Rock and Roll Tour, which was published the year before last, and there's a few stories in there, not all of them, but there's a few stories in that book. But yeah, I've had some great times with Paul all over the place.
Is there any clean ones you can tell me today?
Well, actually, yeah, I suppose there is one. In fact, I do mention this in the book, in the final chapter of Postcards from a Rock and Roll Tour. Paul and I were in Amsterdam, and we were walking around. We were walking over to a cafe for breakfast one morning, and as you know, Amsterdam has just got countless cycles, you know, bicycles. They're all over the place, and if you're not careful, eventually you will be hit by one. And I was hit in 3 days. I was hit three separate times each time I was with Paul, and on the final time, this girl, absolutely gorgeous girl, just smashed straight into me, and she fell to the floor. I was knocked over, and I sort of helped her up, and she got up, and without saying a word, she just picked the bike up, and she went off. She cycled off into the distance, and Paul and I were standing there, shoulder to shoulder, and I said to Paul, why is it, Paul, that it's only gorgeous women that smash into me? And Paul said, it's because you're invisible to them, Gordon. That's known as a Bliss aisle, so Paul Bliss is an expert at quick wit and witty repartee, and his quick wit are known as Bliss Isles. So that was a typical of Paul.
While you were with the Moody Blues, you met up with a Marcus Cliffe.
I had a good run actually around that time. I started playing with a band called Tintin Out, and you may remember they had a hit called Here's Where the Story Ends. And Marcus was in the band, and we had a mutual friend, Lindsay Edwards, who was the main keyboard player and producer. And they had a string of hits, which Marcus and I were involved in. We ended up playing with Mariah Carey, and we were even on Top of the Pops with Emma Bunton, with the number two hit, What I Am. And Marcus and I have been firm friends for about 20 years. So when I thought of putting this band together, he was my first idea of a bass player. He was the one person I would love to have in the band. So when I called him up and asked him to join, he thankfully said yes.
Yeah. Did you ask anybody and they said no?
No, they didn't actually. I asked somebody who wasn't available. I did ask a keyboard player who was originally I was thinking of having two keyboard players. Okay. And I didn't, because Paul had when he finished with the Moodies, he once said to me, I don't know if I fancy going out again as a musician, because he's a great, obviously he's a hit songwriter, and he was looking to go back into songwriting. So I was going to ask Paul, and I did ask somebody else, I won't say who it is, but I did ask another high profile keyboard player who was liked the idea but wasn't available. And then when I mentioned it to Paul said, do you know what, I think I will. So once Paul came on board, it was clear that Paul was all we needed. We don't need two keyboard players. He's brilliant. We'll be right back.
struck a chord. With a smile as bright as sunshine, she called me through the poster and welcomed me aboard. She led me, she fed me, she read me like a book.
I'm Jim Cleland, and every Tuesday between 9 a.m. and 12 p.m. on Seclo Sounds Radio, you can hear all things MK. We have local news, sport, weather, traffic and travel, and lots of music. I'll be talking to local people about fitness, health, what's going on in Milton Keynes, our diverse community, local businesses, and much more. Join me, Jim Cleland, for all things MK every Tuesday between 9 a.m. and 12 p.m. on Seclo Sounds Radio.
That was 10cc and I'm Mandy Fly Me.
Yeah, and then I'm just looking through the things you've done, and it's like a who's who of music, actually. And in 2006...
I've been very lucky, Terry, that's what it is.
Do you know what? A lot of musicians who are successful say that. They say, I mean, I recently had Alan Clark, who you may know from...
From
Dire Straits, and he's now out with his own band called The Straits.
Yeah.
And he said fate, and, you know, he was playing at a couple of working men's clubs, and then Gallagher and Lyle picked him up, and then... basically he was playing with Gallagher and Lyle, and he got a call from, or a visit from the second in command of Dire Straits, saying, "Would you like to tour with a big band?" And he said, "Who is it? I can't tell you." And you know, so he said, "Well, I'm not interested." Then they told him, and he's joined up straight away.
Yeah.
And he said that, you know, the luck is just, you know, I mean, there is many, many talented musicians out there, singers, songwriters, who really need a break. And I'm not sure reality TV always delivers, really, but.
Sometimes it does. You know, and sometimes it doesn't. It's the same with any things, really. There is no. It's a very difficult career to advise people on. I mean, I do get some younger musicians coming to me. I'm 53 now, and if I get musicians who are students of mine that come along who are 17 and 18, and they want to know how to become a successful musician. And it's very difficult, because if they were going to be a solicitor or a lawyer or a doctor, you can tell them, you can tell them exactly the route they need to take. Yeah. You go to university, you get a law degree, you go to the bar, you join a legal company, and you work your way through. Same with medicine, you know, that particular route. But with music, every individual musician has their own unique route to becoming successful. And there is no way you can plan or even guess it. Yeah. You just have to go for it
There's some great stories, actually, about how people have become famous. But in 2006, you went and joined up with Jeff Wayne.
Yes, that's right. Well, obviously, Justin Hayward famously had the hit Forever Autumn on Jeff Wayne's album.
Is that how you got to know Jeff? Through Justin? Or
yes, well, when Justin told me that he was... you see, The War of the Worlds was a favourite album of mine as soon as it was released, and I wore out the vinyl copy, then made a tape of it, and I transcribed every single note off the album when I was a teenager, and just learned it inside out. And I used to play it morning, noon, and night. I used to play along to it, and I loved the album. So when I got the gig with the Moody's, I was disappointed we weren't playing Forever Autumn, but of course it's not a Moody Blues song, it's a War of the Worlds track. So when Justin told me that Jeff had asked him to go and redo his role in the live version, I did ask, my first question was, well, who's going to play drums on it, you know? He said, I don't know, I'll find out. So when they realised they hadn't actually fixed a drummer, Justin recommended me. And thankfully, Jeff sort of said, yeah, OK, well, let's use Gordy then. So that was how I got the gig.
Yeah, and you didn't play on the last, did you play on the last tour?
No, I didn't play on the last tour. There was a diary conflict. Justin and I were booked on a Moody Blues tour when War of the Worlds is going out at the same time, and as great as the War of the Worlds is, it's fantastic. Having been with the Moody's, you know, for 20-something years, I sort of felt a little bit of an obligation to stay with them, and I wanted to. So we did that, and then I put a friend of mine, Aki Yates, in, who's a great drummer, and he went and stood in for me. And he's now pretty much doing that. He's doing the job now.
Because I know you played on the album, though, didn't you?
I played on the new album with Gary Barlow and Josh Stone. Yeah,
and Ricky Wilson of the Kaiser Chiefs.
Yeah, that was great.
Was it? I mean, now he's on The Voice at the moment, isn't he? So
that's right.
Everybody knows him now, but a lot of people, you know, he said Ricky Wilson have no idea who he is. I think they all know the Kaiser Chiefs. So a lot of people know the Kaiser Chiefs.
Yeah,
fabulous band. One of my, I love them as well. So, but let's talk about this book you've written as well.
Yeah.
Postcards
from a Rock and Roll Tour.
Now then, I mean, that must have been, you've had quite a career. You've probably squeezed more in the last sort of 20-30 years than so a lot of people have. It must have been a case of what do I put in and what do I leave out?
No, because it wasn't really, it's part memoir, but it's mostly a travel book, to be honest. It covers one particular tour in 2011 I did, which incorporated America, Canada, and the UK and Europe. And I effectively kept a journal each day because, you know, I'd come home and I'd have a dinner party with people, with friends. And what would be a normal day to me would be sort of extraordinary to anybody else that listens. You know, you're getting on a private plane and flying to Boston and then getting on a bus and driving overnight to New York and playing at the Radio City Music Hall and getting up the next day and bumping into a film star in the lobby. And things, I mean, I have to pinch myself when I tell these stories because it does sound rather extraordinary. But those sort of things do happen when you tour with bands of that ilk. And I started it originally as a blog. And the blog started because I recorded 20 drum lessons, which I put on my... I've got a web page called playdrumswithgordymarshall.com, which was to effectively just give some free lessons and to draw people to the website. The guy that designed the website for me said, why don't you do a blog and just see if you can pull people in to listen to the, you know, watch the drum lessons. Well, the drum lessons, although they're marginally successful, the blog was a lot more popular than the drum lessons were. I think more people wanted to hear about what I was doing rather than learning how to play a paradiddle. So the blog eventually became a book, and then I got a literary agent, and then ultimately it was published. So, yeah, thankfully, it's been... it's not exactly on the New York bestseller list, but it's had some amazing reviews. So, whilst I can't say it's a bestseller, I can claim it's critically acclaimed.
Well, sometimes that's better than being a bestseller.
No, it's Terry, it's not.
It's not because you want the money. You need the money.
It's better to be a bestseller. But still hope it's only been out 18 months.
I know.
These things can take a while.
I mean, also, I think a lot of people know people... You know the bands, but don't necessarily know the people behind the bands, if you see what I mean.
Yeah.
It's like Peter Howarth. I had the pleasure of having him on my show last year. And I knew who he was, but loads of people said to me, who's he? Same as I have Paul Carrick on the show in a couple of weeks' time.
Oh, brilliant. He's fantastic.
And Paul, a lot of people have no idea who he is, but you mention Ace, you mention Squeeze, you mention Roxy Music, you mention Mike and the Mechanics.
Yeah.
Everybody knows him. You know, yep. Do you know what I mean? It's a bit like the guys you've got on this band.
Well, it's exactly right. I mean, the band, my band, The Reflections. If you mention what we're doing in the band is we are representing each of the big bands that the individual musicians play with. So Paul and I played with the Moody Blues. I still play with the Moody Blues. So we're doing some Moody Blues songs. Paul worked with the Hollies for 5 years, so we've got some Hollies hits in there. Obviously, Marcus Cliffe, our bass player, plays with Manfred Mann, so we're doing a few Manfred Mann songs. And Mick Wilson, our singer, who's simply amazing, is the lead singer with 10cc. So we're doing a few 10cc songs. And Huw Davies, our guitarist, because we worked together on the War of the Worlds, we open up the second half with The Eve of the War, which always gets a standing ovation, and then we follow it on with Forever Autumn. So we're touching on all of these amazing bands and musical outfits and just sort of paying tribute to each one of them in our own way.
I think there's something there for everybody. I mean, that Eve of the War, that I must admit, I like that, and it makes the back of my head...
Oh, it's iconic when those opening...
Is, isn't it?
Chords come out, and Paul's done an amazing arrangement of them. And of course, Huw and I know it inside out because we've played it in arenas for 4 or 5 years. So it's great. And Marcus plays the bass. Well, Marcus plays Herbie Flowers' part, of course, bass.
Yeah.
So to have the Manfreds bass player, and Marcus has worked with Eric Clapton, and in fact, he worked with Dire Straits for quite a while. So to have a man of his caliber playing along with us. It's brilliant. It's absolutely fantastic fun.
Yeah, but it's popular. Is it? I get the impression from what you said and what Peter told me. It's a bit like going to a show and sort of basically jamming for 2 hours.
I suppose so, but there's
as a musician, if you like.
Yeah, for the musician. Yeah, it's not a jam.
No.
If you knew the work that goes into creating a show like that, it's months. Honestly, it's months and months and months of meticulous arrangements and working out harmonies and where everybody starts and stops and where all the musical corners are and to make sure everybody's part is right. I mean, there is a couple of occasions in the set where we call it hanging out a bit. So musically, you just sort of you have a bit of room to show what you've got. But for the most part, they are meticulously worked out arrangements of classic songs. Because when someone comes to see us, if you've got a Cliff Richard fan and they hear, they will know Devil Woman. They'll know Miss You Nights, and they'll know Carrie. They'll know they'll know those records in the back of their minds, and they'll want to hear something that's not just somebody jamming around that song. We've done particular arrangements of them. And the same with 10cc, we're doing Wall Street, and we're doing I'm Mandy Fly Me, and Dreadlock Holiday. And obviously, I'm Not In Love, or as Marcus, our bass player, says, I'm Not In Love. So when we do those songs, we really have spent a lot of time making sure that they sound as pristine and as perfect as they possibly can do.
Well, I didn't really mean it like, as in you turn up and just jam. I mean,
your suggestion down. Sorry.
No, that's fine. No, I mean, I suppose really it's the next generation of supergroups, isn't it, that you've got
I suppose
there.
It is really. going back to what you said before about not knowing who Peter Howarth was, for instance, or Carrick, individually, we're not that well known, but the bands that we've all played with are obviously, you know, iconic, world-famous artists and groups. So the people that come along may not know us individually, but collectively, obviously, they'll know all of the songs.
Mm. I mean, since I know you still tour with the Moody Blues, but in between you've been doing some sort of West End stuff.
Yeah, I've played in lots of West End shows, actually. There's nice little sort of nice little earners, I suppose, for want of a better description, for when you're not doing a big tour and you come home and you suddenly find yourself twiddling your thumbs on a Tuesday morning. Mm. I play in Thriller Live, which is the Michael Jackson show at the Lyric Theatre.
And you do that regularly, do you?
Pardon?
Do you do that regularly?
I do it about... Well, I go and I'm a deputy, so I'm called when the regular drummer can't do it, and also Aki Yates, who now plays drums on the War of the Worlds, that's his show on percussion and keyboards. So Aki calls me when he can't do the show, and I go in and it's called depping. I dep for Aki on percussion and keys, and then I dep for Mike Bradley, the drummer. So I'm sometimes, like this week, I've only got one show to do. I'm playing on Tuesday. No, I did Tuesday this week. Last week, I did five shows in. I did three percussion shows and two shows on drums. And next week, I've got four. So it's sort of, you know, it's nice to keep your chops in, that's for sure.
I looked, and you played on some very, you know, very sort of famous shows. Fame?
Yeah, well, that was my show. I did that for 6 years in the West End of London. That was going on at the same time as the Moody Blues and the War of the Worlds started. So I was holding three jobs down at that point. I was going out and touring with the Moody Blues three times in that year. And then I went out and with the War of the Worlds. And then all of the days in between, I was going in and trying to hold down Fame and hoping that the musical director wasn't going to get too peeved off with me for putting in a debt for 6 weeks while I went on the Moody Blues tour, for 6 weeks while I went out on the War of the Worlds. It's supposed to be my job and I was hardly in it, you know. But,
that's what I call being greedy, three jobs.
I know, but you know, you've got to make hay while the sun shines, haven't you? And I'll tell you what did happen. As soon as the War of the Worlds tour finished, and I'd done, I think it was 4 or 5 weeks rehearsals and a six-week tour, and just prior to that, I'd been on tour with the Moody Blues, and then the show stopped. So the Moody Blues only did one tour the following year. The War of the Worlds stopped, and the show stopped. So I went from having three jobs to no jobs.
Ah, oh, that's no good.
That's the nature of the business.
It is, isn't it? I mean, you did Greece for a while as well, I think.
Yeah, I depped on Greece. I didn't play in there regularly. So Greece and Whistle Down the Wind and We Will Rock You. And,
did you?
What else have I done?
Mamma Mia. Rent.
Rent. Yeah. All of those shows, they were my shows, but I went and I was a deputy on each of those shows. So I would go in and spend a period of time going in when the regular musician couldn't do it.
Mm. So whose idea was this getting the band together, Reflections Band? Was it your idea? Or?
Yeah, it was me. I was sitting at home thinking... in fact, I've had a number of occasions throughout my career where I've been, you know, you think you missed a session because everyone's calling you, and then suddenly it can stop. And you find yourself sitting at home for 3 months thinking, hang on a minute, where's everybody gone? And you're sitting there waiting for the phone to ring.
The phone's not working.
It always picks up again and everything's fine, but I don't like sitting around doing nothing. Mm. And I was looking through my address book one day and realised that I've got a world-class band in my address book. Mm. And there are theatres out there, and I know some great agents, and I know some great people. So I just came up with the idea and started calling people. And thankfully, everybody just went, yeah, okay, that sounds great, so let's do it.
Mm. I mean, it must be great. We'll talk about where people can see you. I know it's the opening night of the tour this year, isn't it? You're local to us.
Yes, the Stables in Wavendon in Milton Keynes on Wednesday, the 26th of February.
You've just given it a good plug. Gordy, after that plug, I think we better take a break. Let's play some tracks. You sent me some tracks you specially recorded for this show today. With Mick Wilson, of the lead singer of 10cc. Going to play three in a row. They're only short acoustic tracks. First, we're going to start off with Nights in White Satin, then the classic Cliff Richard song, Devil Woman, and of course, 10cc's immortal, I'm Not in Love.
Never reaching the end, letters I've written, never meaning to send. Beauty I've always missed, these eyes before. Just what the truth is, I can't take anymore. 'Cause I love you. Yes, I love you. Oh, how I love you. How I love you. Yes, I love you.
Best travel locations around the globe, book your seat for the John Gwynne Travel Show on Seclo Sounds every Monday at 12 noon. Hear the latest advice and recommendations to help you achieve maximum enjoyment and value from your trip, no matter where you want to go or what you want to do. Also, check out John's travel report as he reveals the things that the travel industry could do better. The John Gwynne Travel Show, Mondays at 12 noon on Seclo Sounds. Check it out before you check in. This is Seclo Sounds, your community radio station. If you'd like to volunteer some of your time and skills with Seclo Sounds, send an email to volunteers@seclosounds.org and let us know how you would like to be involved. Just because
We've just had a call from JVB, and they're after a new logo.
Okay, let's call our logo agency.
Oh, and Jones & Sons need a new brochure.
Right, I'll get on to our brochure agency.
Ah, and they'll need some custom illustrations.
Right, I'll call our illustrator.
And bespoke photography.
Okay. And I'll call our photographer.
Tired of having to find a million different people to cover all your creative needs? With over 20 years of experience in a wide variety of media, Grant Kempster can take care of everything, including commercial and corporate designs, illustration and photography.
And finally, we need some leaflets and ads doing for John Smith Associates.
No problem. I'll give Grant Kempster a call.
For more information, visit grantkempster.com.
There we are, three great tracks recorded especially for this show here on Seclo Sounds. First we heard Nights in White Satin, then we heard Devil Woman, and then we heard I'm Not in Love. Those were recorded a couple of days ago by Gordy and Mick, especially for this show. Anyhow, let's return and have a little finish the chat with Gordy Marshall. Let's talk about sort of other things as well. I mean, are you looking to record an album together as the band, or...?
Yeah, we are actually. In fact, we've one of the executive decisions I made was to buy our own sound system rather than, because when we went out last year, we had some rather hairy experiences with different sound systems, whether it was in-house or hired or using someone else's sound system, because we didn't know it. We had some difficult times, you know, sort of 4 and 5 hour sound checks. So what we've done is we've bought our own mixing desk. It's called, for the tech people, it's a Behringer X32, which is the new kid on the block in terms of digital mixers. And we are all DI'd, direct input, straight into this desk. So we take that desk with us. And what happens is we just take cables out of the back of that desk. That is our monitor desk and our front of house desk at the same time. And that feeds into the house system or any speakers that we hire for the night. What this desk also does is if you take a USB cable out the back of it and plug it into your computer, you can record 32 tracks of digital tracks down to any software like Logic or Cubase or any of the major recording pieces of software, and you can record everything as an album at any point, direct from the desk.
Wow.
And we did it with our first rehearsals, and it sounds amazing. So what we're going to do is probably record every night and make them available as live albums.
Really? Straight after the show or later?
Well, no, well, there's a little issue with that. It won't be straight after the show because, first of all, you've got to mix it. Because all those signals, each 32 channels, which is what we produce as a band, we have 32 separate channels, they all go down separately onto your computer as a digital channel, digital sound source. Then you've got to mix them together, like a front of house mixer would do. So you have to do that. Then you have to press it to a CD. So it won't be available on the night, but we're recording everything. We're recording all of the rehearsals and all of the shows because of this new sound system that we've got.
Well, it just goes to show how technology's moved on, doesn't it? And
it's remarkable. Yeah, it really is.
Business. Yeah, because, I mean, you've probably seen some big changes apart from that over in the sort of 20, 30 years you've been in the music business.
Yeah. Well, basically, when I first started with the Moody Blues, for instance, I had a sound system surrounding that. I had my own sounds. Everybody on stage had their own monitor system, which was bigger than some front of house systems you'd use in a club, for instance. I mean, I remember playing at the Hollywood Bowl and looking around me, and the speakers surrounding me were just. I'd got bass speakers under the drum riser. I want to play the snare drum. It sounded like a cannon going off. And it's very dramatic, but it doesn't do your hearing much good. And, of course, it moves on. Now we all use these in-ear monitors.
That's right. Yeah,
which are molded to your... They're bespoke monitors for your ears. And you can control your own mix. And it's far superior because you don't get any bleed from the stage into the vocal mics. So it's a far better sound, not only for the people on stage, but for the people out front.
Okay, two more questions and I'll let you go. Is there anybody you'd like to work with? Is there anybody you wish you'd worked with?
Or Sting.
Sting from the Police?
Yeah.
I hope he's listening.
Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder, ah. Oh, yeah.
And Elton John.
You'd like to work with Elton? Well, Elton.
Yeah, I'd love to work with Elton. And anybody else that had me, actually.
Anybody that have you, you'd just like to work. Okay. Any unfulfilled ambitions? Any ambition anything you'd like to have done or would love to do now?
The Three Peaks Challenge I'd like to do.
Yeah,
which is climbing all the highest mountains in England, Scotland and Wales within 24 hours. I think that might have passed me by, Terry. I do go running every day, so I'm sort of relatively fit. But.
Yeah, I definitely passed me by. I'm very similar age to you, so we're...
What I do want to do is my the book that I've written, Postcards from a Rock and Roll Tour, I signed a 3-book deal with Splendid Books, so I would like to have a trilogy of books out. So I'm working hard on the second one.
Oh, what's the second one going to be all about?
I haven't got a postcard. I haven't got a title for it yet. But it's probably Postcards from Rock and Roll Tour 2,
okay.
Or a return to, or I don't know. Maybe somebody can think of. Maybe one of your listeners can think of a title for it.
I don't know. I mean, even letters from a rock and roll tour.
Letters from a rock and roll.
And then make the third
good.
One emails from a rock and roll tour.
Yeah, you could do all of that.
I'm being facetious. last question: what's your favourite song, either one you've worked on, or and another one?
Terry, now
save the last.
Probably
question.
Stumped me now.
I've saved the last question.
Yeah, I tell you what. Probably "Woman" by John Lennon.
Is your favourite, isn't it?
Is one of my all-time favourites. I tell you what, I'm a huge fan of Earth, Wind and Fire.
Oh, yes.
So, any one of theirs.
Boogie Wonderland.
But I'm also a big classical fan. So, Rachmaninoff is my favourite composer, I'm afraid.
Okay.
So, Rach's Second Piano Concerto is, I will put that on in the car if I've got a long journey, and I will listen to that from start to end.
Okay, and what about one of the songs you've worked on?
Well, if I look through the set list of what we're doing, they're all great songs. I mean, the Moody songs I know inside out, and I do have a particular appreciation for those, for the Moody Blues music. I think they are going to be heralded as evergreen composers in centuries to come.
Yeah.
Nights in White Satin, I simply love. The Voice, Wildest Dreams, I Know You're Out There Somewhere, we're doing all of those. I think the Moody's material is probably some of my favourite ever.
Stuff. Okay, so let's quickly go through. It's called The Reflections in Concert. We have with Paul Bliss, who is the keyboard player from the Hollies and the Moody Blues. We've got Marcus Cliffe, the bass player from Manfred Mann.
Yep.
Huw Davies, the guitarist from War of the Worlds. We've got yourself.
You now know all about.
Gordy Marshall. Who's with the thing. And we've also got the new member of the band, Mick Wilson, who many people will know was the lead singer of 10cc.
He still is the lead singer of
10cc. Well, you're currently all playing with those bands. And everybody can see you at the Stables Theatre in Wavendon on Wednesday the 26th of February.
That's correct.
Thank you very much for your time today, Gordy.
Terry, thank you very much indeed. It's been great to talk to you.
Absolute pleasure.
MK Flyers Online, the fast and simple way to find any kind of business or service locally. Find us at mkflyersonline.co.uk or download the MK Flyers mobile app from your app store. MK Flyers Online proudly supports Seclo Sounds, community radio for Milton Keynes.
midnight on the 12th of August, a huge mass of luminous gas erupted from Mars and sped towards Earth. Across 200 million miles of void, invisibly hurtling towards us, came the first of the missiles that were to bring so much calamity to Earth. As I watched, there was another jet of gas. It was another missile, starting on its way.
It was for the next 10 nights. A flare spurting out from Mars, bright green, drawing a green mist behind it, a beautiful but somehow disturbing sight. Ogilvy, the astronomer, assured me we were in no danger. He was convinced there could be no living thing on that remote, forbidding planet.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
Then came the night the first missile approached Earth. It was thought to be an ordinary falling star, but next day there was a huge crater in the middle of the column, and Ogilvy came to examine what lay there. A cylinder, 30 yards across, glowing hot, and with faint sounds of movement coming from within. Suddenly the top began moving, rotating, unscrewing, and Ogilvy feared there was a man inside trying to escape. He rushed to the cylinder, but the intense heat stopped him before he could burn himself on the metal.
The chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. Chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come. Yes, the chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, he said. Chances of anything coming from Mars are a million to one, but still they come.
shop and she would show me what she bought. All the people stared as if we were both quite insane. Someday my name and hers are going to be the same. Bus stop, wet day, she's there, I say, please share my umbrella. Bus stop, bus go, she stays, love grows under my umbrella. All that summer we enjoyed it, wind and rain and shine. That umbrella we...
There we are, that's two tracks from the Reflections band. First we heard the immortal Jeff Wayne's Water Worlds, with Huw Davies, the guitarist, playing on that. And then after that, we heard from the Hollies, we heard Bus Stop with Paul Bliss, who's the keyboard player with Reflections. An absolute pleasure today to have Gordy Marshall on the show. Next week on the show, we have two more musical legends. We have Sean Cannon and Eamon Campbell. You may not know the names, but they are the two members of the Dubliners. They're on next week on the show. Really looking forward to that. Now, we're almost out of time. As always, I've been Terry Sullivan. This has been the Styx Radio Show. Until next time, it's bye for now.
MK Pulse proudly sponsors Seclo Sounds. MK Pulse is Milton Keynes' local magazine, bringing helpful information on food, health, fashion, money, travel, culture, and much more to 66,000 readers every month. Plus, news, views, and what's on from around the city. If it's happening in Milton Keynes, it's in MK Pulse. And it's available online at www.mkpulse.co.uk. MK Pulse and Seclo Sounds, the heart and soul of the city.